Welcome back from that break. We are still looking at the impact all forms of violence, sexual violence, emotional violence, we have physical violence. How do these forms of violence affect children? And if you've just joined in, we're looking at why it is prevalent despite the existing laws. And we have realized that from what Peter has told us, that you have a responsibility, you have a role to play. Please don't see a child being violated and just look on and walk on by. Yeah, this is why I'm actually asking Peter. Peter is a senior program officer with Raising Voices. Now I want to know, Peter, how do I wake up and say, I think this child is being violated, he's being abused. How do I come in? How do I get the confidence, you know, to approach a neighbor's child? I was watching TV the other day. A father to this child got a feeling that his daughter was being sexually abused at school by a certain teacher. He knew. So he goes to school and actually confronts this gentleman. On confrontation, I don't know, I think he was angry or something. He boxed this teacher. He gave him about 3 punches and the guy collapsed. Well, luckily he didn't die. But you know, how do I start getting those feelings?
Okay. One thing I would advocate for, Lynn, don't use violence.
Of course not.
To fight violence.
Yes.
Because then you are kind of like perpetrating
violence.
I think there are better ways. If this person had reported to police, he wouldn't have been. Now he has a case to answer.
But Peter, police are the perpetrators of most of these cases. Sometimes.
Yes, but we have to have faith at some point. Faith keeps us going. If God doesn't give me what I want today, do I stop praying?
Of course not.
I have to keep praying until one day God will give me. And so we have to have faith that if I report to police, did I follow up? I need to follow up and go back and say, officer, I reported a case here. What has been done? It is also my responsibility to say, look, I'm tracking because that child I know is in danger. That's why I reported. So what have you done? And so if also the police know that we are keeping our eyes open, we are, you know,
vigilant.
We have our hands are on their necks, then they will do what we need to. Because sometimes we also sit back and we think, things will work out themselves. When you're on WhatsApp, you have to click to send a message.
True.
So if we want police to act, we also need to click them to act. Ensure that, you know, we are on their case. Now, how do I see or know that a child is being abused? If your neighbor, it's at 7 p.m. And this little child is outside, everybody else is inside the house, already something is wrong. So how can the adults be in the house and this child is outside the house? They could have been locked out because of maybe they did something wrong. That's already shows you. You know,
something is not right.
Yes, you as a mother, you as an adult, you're saying, look, no, it's wrong. If a child is supposed to be in school at this time, you know, and you ask yourself, really? Child is supposed to be in class. You already, you know, you're... senses of responsibility are being triggered. If you see everybody else is eating and this child is not eating,
something is not right.
Is wrong somewhere. But there are others that, you know, are obvious. You are in your house and you hear a child, you know, wailing and they're being caned. Definitely, you know, that is violence.
Now that you mentioned that, my neighbor's child is always crying every other time.
Yes.
I want to walk up to them and be like, why is this child always crying? But I don't want to come off as rude or as, you know, interrupting the situation.
You may choose an opportune moment, like if you had a neighborhood party. And then, you know, when people are disarmed, you know, they are all merry, and then you say, oh, neighbor. You know, how are you? You know, I work with Urban TV, you know, I work with Raising Voices. You know, we do programs around children. I hear your child crying a lot.
Is everything
okay? Something wrong? Is everything okay? Try to have a conversation.
Right.
Depending on on how you know the person.
Mm.
If it's a relative, it's easy to, you know. If it's a friend, it's easy to. But if it's a neighbor you don't know very well, it may be a challenge. But sometimes we can report anonymously.
True.
You report and say, you know, 116, and say, guys, my neighbor here, there's something that goes on in the house. I suspect it's violence against that child.
Mm.
Please, could you investigate? In a way, you have played your role. You've not endangered your relationship with your neighbor, but at least you have helped the child. Because the important thing, you know, in this work we are doing, this program we are doing, are we doing it in the best interest of the child?
True.
Are we keeping a child from harm?
Mm.
That is should be the overriding factor. Not my relationship with my relatives. Not my relationship with my neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
That is secondary.
Yeah.
The first thing is, is that child out of danger?
True.
You are asking about other marks. For example, you know how children play?
Yep.
They play and fall over.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll find that a child will fall on their knees. There's a way they'll fall.
Mm-hmm.
But if you find a child has a mark around the stomach, how does a child fall on the stomach? It's rare because we fall
on our knees. And
there's a certain posture we adopt as we fall. And so, as a medical doctor, if you're examining a child and you see, you know, a mark on the thighs,
in the back,
that should tell you, look,
something
is wrong.
Yeah.
And so we need to be not overly suspicious.
Mm-hmm.
But where a child is concerned, healthy suspicion is good.
Mm.
Healthy, not unhealthy. You know, sometimes we may think, it's abuse, when actually it's not.
Right.
But as a dose of suspicion helps. Because even, you know, as you as a lady, as you're walking on the street, there's a way you hold your bag.
Mm-hmm.
You're suspicious that the next person could grab it,
yeah.
It's healthy for you. It keeps you, you know, you keep your bag. And so, as protectors of children,
mm-hmm.
as people who help children, we need to be mindful that we have a role to play. And so whenever we are suspicious, take that extra step of asking a question or reporting.
Mm.
Sometimes we want to see it in real action in order to report. If we are suspicious that a teacher is having improper sexual relations with the child, we shouldn't wait until the child is pregnant. We shouldn't wait until the child is
pregnant. But children at school are hard to monitor.
We should report. Yeah, they're hard to monitor. But we're saying whenever we are suspicious, whenever we see, if you're a teacher and I am a teacher and you see me having inappropriate relations with the child, it's upon you to say, look, Peter, what you're doing
is
not good. I'm going to report to the administration, to the head teacher. And it's incumbent upon the head teacher to investigate and bring in, because when it is defilement, it's no longer between me and you.
Mm.
It's a criminal offense.
Yes.
You know, so we bring in the police and whatever.
Mm.
Let me tell you, you would rather lose a friend who is me, who is doing harm to children, than lose that child.
Yeah.
Because it will live with you. You'll say, I wish I had done something.
Mm.
I could have done something. Remember, we have our hands here.
Mm.
The power is in our hands. Sometimes we assume the power is with the police to act. The power is with the LC. No. In whatever capacity you are, you have the power to do something. So there are many ways that we can actually tell that a child is being abused. You look at a child who, among other children, they are withdrawn.
Yeah.
They have low self-esteem.
Yeah.
They always come late to school. They are aggressive whenever they are playing with fellow children.
Mm.
Those are signs that actually something may be wrong.
Mm.
Because when a child is extremely aggressive, whenever they want to resolve issues, they want to use violence.
Yes.
You as a teacher, you like to say, okay, something might be wrong. So when you investigate, you may find that at home, it is father and mother solve their problems using
violence.
Yeah. Brothers and sisters use violence. Mm. The maid and the employer use violence. And so then you help. We have to break the cycle. If we don't break the cycle of violence, then it becomes a problem that we live with.
You mentioned something that we should be on the lookout. I remember I was in high school, senior 5 or 6, and I fell ill. I didn't know I was sick. I lost weight. I was very tiny, and I had no appetite. So I go home for holidays, and my mom looks at me suspiciously. The first thing she told me was like, "I think you're pregnant." I laughed at her because, man, I was still a virgin then, and she laughed. She said, "I am serious, Lynn. You're pregnant. You need to tell me these things." She became so harsh with me, and you know, constantly asking me, "Who is the perpetrator? Who did this? Why don't you tell me? You don't." So I told her, "Mommy, I am not pregnant." So she takes me to my dad, of course, sit down with your dad, and tells him, "I think Lynn is pregnant, and she doesn't want to tell us." Man is like, "Are you sure? Have you taken her to hospital?" So they took me to hospital and found I had malaria, typhoid, and blah, blah, blah. So this discussion reminds me that she was very, you know, observant and trying to figure out what is wrong with my child. And her fear was I could be pregnant. Somebody could have, you know, impregnated me at a young age. So people and parents out there, you need to know and always look out for your children. Stop being angry all the time. Yes, they have issues. Yes, you have issues. But take an extra, you know, look at the children. Have a relationship.
Yeah, and children don't become pregnant all of a sudden. Sometimes we lose track. You know, and so there's the other side of it where we can prevent violence by creating time for our children, by having positive relationships with our children, by having a conversation, an ongoing conversation.
Peter, we need to take a break. When we come back, I want him to tell us what the available interventions are. And of course, we'll take a look at what social media has to say. We're asking how these forms of violence eventually impact on the children as they grow up. We'll be right back.